All right, good morning, everyone. We'll go ahead and get started with Coach Traylor. Just please use the raise hand function, and I'll call on you for questions. JJ, you're up first.
Jeff, what were some of your big takeaways this week from the East Carolina game?
Well, kind of went as expected. We knew it was going to be a game of huge plays. Their defense plays such a style. And we had 10 plays for over 450 yards and probably had another 60 plays that went for 60 yards. Kind of the way they make you play. Defensively, we got off kind of a slow start. They hit some big passes on us, did a really good job. We got settled in, did a good job. And special teams were kind of a stalemate, not really, our punt return team didn't get really a chance. We were in punt safe so much most of the night, so we didn't get a chance to return a punt. And our kickoff return team only got a couple of chances. And Lucas hit some bombs, which was nice. Overall, just a good football game that glad to get out there with a win.
What does it mean to you that your offense is able to be able to connect on some of those big plays?
Well, it's not real great for your defense, but we had kind of prepared our defense for that all week, that we weren't going to be out there very long. We were going to either hurry up and score or hurry up and punt. And it's just the way they make you play. And so it was fun to see. But it's not a sustainable way to win championships. You got to be able to run the football and play great defense and kick it. And East Carolina just is not going to let you do it.
Greg?
Jeff, we didn't get a chance after the game to ask you about Trey Moore ending up as the school's single season sack record through only 8 games here. What does it mean to you? And what can you say about the level he's playing at right now?
Kid's just relentless. He's a high character kid. He's very twitchy. He's tough. He comes from a great program in Smithson Valley, but he just will not stop. The kid's a tireless competitor. He's the epitome of a guy that gives perfect effort at all times. He's awesome. He's just the poster child for what you want for an edge rusher.
We asked him after the game if he was surprised at all that he was able to do it so quickly and despite the injury, and he basically said no. It seems like he's a very confident player. Has he always had that in him, or has that developed over his career?
No, Trey's never lacked for self-confidence. That's never been an issue. He's raised by really good people, comes from a great program. That's all they teach out there, and that community is a fantastic community that has, breathed a lot of life into Trey. And Trey knows who he is. And is an unbelievable football player, and we're very blessed to have him on our team.
Steven?
Jeff, how's the team look health-wise coming out of East Carolina?
Yeah, that one was a rough one. I told my training staff, they came to bat me with any more bad news, I was going to suspend them for a few games. It was all bad news. And we'll see what we look like today. We had a long report yesterday. And we'll see what that looks like, today, and get an update and see what tomorrow's practice looks like.
Looking ahead this week at North Texas, it's a place that historically the Roadrunners haven't done well at. What are you guys going to have to do to kind of reverse that trend this week?
Well, they're hot right now. I know they've lost a couple of games, but they've played two of the best teams in our conference. They were losing to Tulane and rallied back and took and tied that game up in the fourth quarter. And then, Pratt drove him down the field and scrambled into the end zone almost, with less than a minute left in the ball game. Last week, they had driven down, looked like they had beaten Memphis, and then Memphis to 36, 37-yard post route with hardly any time left. So, Eric's got him playing well. He's found him a quarterback. And I understand he took over a good job. They got beat in the conference championship game. So, it's not like he went in there with a broken job, and he's a really good football coach and a great offensive mind. And he's got a quarterback. He's got good receivers. He's got really good running backs that we struggle to tackle since we've been here. So they're a good football team.
JJ.
Jeff, how would you evaluate the play of the defense against East Carolina?
I thought they played really well in the second half. We got off to kind of a slow start, but that post pattern, Nick was in a good spot. Kid made a great play. And then we had a trip. It's a 15-yard penalty, and they hit the deep over on us. And then we threw the pick six. So it was not a great start, obviously, but we really rallied and finished well.
I wanted to ask you about JT Clark. We saw he didn't suit up. What's his status this week and moving forward?
I need to speak to JT about that just before we release the information. He's got some stuff coming up this week, and then we'll let that become public. I just want to make sure I'm good with him before I speak on that.
Greg.
Jeff, we saw Owen Peewee get his most significant action since he's been a Roadrunner. What did you see from him and his performance? What stood out from that game?
Yeah, he was one of our players of the game. He was very active, and really proud of him. There was a play on special teams I wish he'd have made. There's a tackle he missed on the quarterback I wish he'd have made. But none of them played perfect, but he played really well. And as I repeat, he was a triangle toughness player of the game, one of them.
He was pretty heralded in the recruiting process, but it seemed like he really had a year here to sort of develop and just work on some things. What did he get out of last season? How have you seen him grow?
He's been good since he's been here. He's just in a long line of great players. When you come in and you're behind Adrian Taylor and Donye Taylor, and you know, that's just some good players. It's nothing that Pee-wee's done wrong. It's about like it should be when you're in a really good program. You kind of learn the game. You play special teams. You get out there on nickel and dime packages. You keep making plays. And that's the way a natural progression should go in a really good program.
Who else do you have available at that position right now? It seems like a spot where you've been hit pretty hard through the season.
We've got Marcellus Wilkerson. We tend to be back this week, and he's been playing well. So we've got Donye. We've got him. So whenever you're three deep and you're still healthy this time of year, you're doing really well.
Steven?
Coach, Saturday, Cephas got to 3,000 receiving yards. What did you say to him after the game, or what does it mean to you? And then what has just the receiving core brought this season?
They've gotten better each week. You know, obviously, when you have the injury to JT that did not go as we foresaw, you know, we thought he might be back for game one, then we thought he'd be back for game five. And now you're going into whatever game we're going into, game nine, and we still don't have him. So Tyke's really come on. You know, David Amador is a young receiver, Willie McCoy, Devin McEwen. Those guys have really come on. And Josh has been the mainstay the entire time. And he's just steady like he's always been. He's a great leader in practice. He's a great leader on the sideline. And really happy that he had the success that he did Saturday night.
And then looking at the running backs, you've kind of gotten to where you're having the three guys in rotation like you said you wanted all year. What has stood out about that?
Just that. There's three of them, and you're going to need them all down the stretch. And, you know, last year, about right now, we were down to one. So we're glad to have three, and it's glad to get Brandon out there. You know, Kadrick has played. I want to get Brandon out there, get him some reps in case we need him down the stretch.
Greg?
Jeff, what stood out about how Corey Godinet has played as he's continued to get his feet wet at this level this season?
Yeah, he just keeps getting better each week. Again, he's another triangle toughness player of the game. Greg, you must be doing a really good job of watching the video. You need to grade that stuff better than PFF does. Yeah, he's a big, strong kid, great attitude. He's really shored up that offensive line because it allowed us to move some guys around. And really excited. Great human being, extremely strong. Whenever we put their picture up for a Triangle Toughness of the Award winner, the kids always make fun of whoever's picture is up. And when Corey's picture went up, like, there was a hush in the room, and everybody's like, nobody make fun of him. He's one of those kind of guys you don't want mad at you.
And you mentioned after the game how Tyke Ogo-Kellogg had some blocks that sort of sprung some big gains for Cephas on the plays that really stood out for him. Has Tyke always had that as a strength, or how has he developed as a blocker through his time with you guys?
That's developed. You know, he's got unbelievable size, and he just – his work ethic's just flipped. It's just been a great year for Tyke. I'm so excited for him. You know, he's going into game nine now and started every one of them, and, you know, it's just awesome how far he's come on and off the field. And he was so happy about it too, man. He was really thrilled for Josh, and Our culture pillar of the week is selfless this week. And imagine we're going to celebrate Josh, his run, but also Ty Key's block on so many of those. And really happy for the young man.
JJ?
Jeff, without getting into details, it seems like you guys are a little thin at maybe the outside linebacker positions. Are you planning on moving some guys over, or what's the plan there in case you got a guy that or two that can't go?
Yeah, we're going to be okay. At the Sound, we've still got Donye. We've got Marcellus. We've got, you know, Pee-wee. Now, we did lose Pig Cage, to Greg's point earlier. At the Will, we've got Trey. We've got Jamori. You know, we lost Nana early in the year at Texas State. But we moved Ron out there. And if we had to, we could move Pee-wee or Donye over there. We've still got some flexibility there. But it's getting that time of year where you got to start looking around for you run out of people. So we're as deep as we've ever been. Thank goodness. We've recruited well the last couple of years, and we've hit on a lot of kids. So we've got a lot of guys back in there that can play.
Greg?
Jeff, as you got a chance to review the film, what stood out about maybe some of the chippy play or some of the factors that led to that? And how did you feel like your guys handled those situations through the game?
I'm not going to comment on that. You could go watch the game, and I work hard for my money, and I don't want to give any of it away.
Understood. Well, then changing gears, then you mentioned the weather this week. How do you adjust for that in practice, if at all?
Yeah, it's going to be one of those weeks. You know, I already talked to them about it last night. I don't want to hear a bunch of moaning and griping and complaining. Championship football team. So it's the coaches that are going to be freezing. Once their big rear ends get moving around, they're going to be just fine. It's going to feel great once we get through warm-up. But, you know, it's us old men over there that are going to be freezing with snot running down and having my gloves on. They'll all be making fun of me. But it is what it is. We'll go out there and get to work, and that's what we're going to do. We can't get in the Alamo done because the floor's not down. So we'll be outside like the old school guys, just toughing it out.
Would you ever consider adjusting to an afternoon or evening schedule when it might be a little bit warmer, or is that just too disruptive?
Our class schedule is not set up that way. You know, we've got all of our class schedules where it's cleared out in the morning. So those guys are in class and pretty much noon on. So it just won't work. But that's a great option. If we had it, you just can't move the schedule around. I don't imagine President Amy or our provost will sign off on our kids getting a missed class to go to football practice.
AJ?
But Greg, I'll tell the players that was your recommendation. That'll make you a fan favorite immediately in our locker room.
That's what I would do, so.
Jeff, we got about a month left in the season. What's your take on how the conference is shaping up? It seems like there's a couple of top-heavy teams at the top of the conference.
I haven't looked. I couldn't even tell you. I know North Texas has played Tulane really tough, and they played Memphis really tough, and that's all I know about, brother. But y'all let me know how it looks. I know the Roadrunners got North Texas next, and that's the only place my eyes have been.
The North Texas had a pretty dramatic ending there this past week against a good Memphis team. Well, what did you take away from watching?
How good they are on offense. You know, how they went right down the field against a really good Memphis defense and looked like it won the game. And then what a great play. You know, a quarterback, Hennigan's been there for a while at Memphis and threw a really good post route. Guy went up and made a great play to win the ball game. And it just shows you how close those guys are to have to play two, you know, of the teams that are picked to win our league, you know, back to back, and played their tails off. And you're one play of winning from winning both of them. Quarterback's really good. Y'all are going to enjoy watching him play if you like offense. Running backs are really good. We've struggled tackling those guys for years. And those receivers, man, Nine's a real dude. And those other receivers can catch it and make something happen after they catch it.
Do you guys talk to the players any about this being a rivalry game, or is that just kind of something that's a function of the matchup?
No, we don't. We didn't even know it was homecoming last week. We just put the ball down and play. We don't talk about that stuff. We got y'all for that. I told y'all. That's what y'all get them going. Y'all got all kinds of stuff y'all do out there to get them going. I just try to coach the ball the best that I can. I struggle doing my job, JJ, much less y'all's.
Okay, Greg, we'll go to you.
Jeff, you mentioned that North Texas has had a tough couple of weeks here playing really top teams in the league and coming up short in dramatic ways. I'm curious from a coaching perspective, is that something that's more draining on a team, or does that motivate a team to get over the hump in another big game against the top opponent? How does that, what sort of impact do you expect from that?
It's always a fine line. I talked to our guys about it last night. You know, we've won four games in a row now. How are they going to take their coaching? Are they going to be hungry and humble, or are they going to be, you know, I say the same quotes. I know y'all get tired of hearing them all the time, but desperate people live differently than prosperous people do. And on the token, like in September, when we were getting we were losing those games, kind of like North Texas is right now. How did our kids handle that? Well, it made our kids mad, and they got better because of it. And especially with Eric being new there, and they got a quarterback, and they got everything kind of going, I would imagine they're going to handle that thing just perfectly, and we're going to get their very best effort Saturday, if I had to bet. But I'm not a betting man.
I think right after the game, you and a couple of the players referenced the last time you guys went to Denton. How much do you talk about that game and that trip up there?
Well, as much as you'd like to forget about it, you just can't. I mean, you know, they kicked our tail in that day, and it was a beatdown, to be honest with you. And those same backs are there. Those same ones we couldn't tackle that day are still toting that thing. So, you know, you don't have to talk about it. They know. And that was a rough day, and it still bothers us, but nothing we can do about it now, except go out there and try to be better for it.
Even going back before your tenure here, UTSA has not had a lot of success there historically. Is there anything about that environment that makes it particularly hard to play?
They got a great fan base. I mean, it's a proud university. They've been playing football for a long time. And like I said earlier, when you fire a coach, when he gets beaten in the conference championship, those expectations are high. So that place expects to do well. And they've got great facilities. They've got a great place to recruit. It's a really good job. It's one of the better jobs, you know, for sure in our conference.
Is there anything else for Coach Traylor this morning? All right. Thanks, everyone.
God bless. Birds up.
Thanks, Jeff.